Welcome to England, which you like.
I love, yes, I love England. You know, there's an old French saying, jamais deux sans trois. That means never twice without a third time. And I've lived here twice before, always connected with work. Mm. And this will be the third time.
Third time lucky. But work for in England has been good work then, eh?
Yes, it's always been good work. And it's been, I find working in the theatre here, I mean, when I came here 10 years ago to be in Applause, I was, thrilled at the prospect, obviously, last playing in England. I mean, for all actors, we all feel in America that playing in the West End is the peak. Because this is synonymous with the best theatre that there is in the world.
I wonder whether it's because you're not living in your own country and here you get a kind of relief, because you're quite a nervous performer, you've said, aren't you? You're nervous about everything.
Yes.
Pretty well.
Yes.
Well, when you're not home, I wonder if there's a relief in, you feel...
I think that's true. You don't have the pressures of home, of the kitchen of life, as we call it.
That's
you don't have to deal with all of that. Which I think does take... So the edge is taken off immediately when you go to another country. And you can enjoy the other country because it's not... You're living in a place that's not your own, although you make it feel your own. Still, you don't have that day-to-day thing that is... I think that's true. Yes.
Can I also suggest that, that the theatre must have been a great big warm bath for you to get into, because perhaps you were slightly living down the past of the films, which were brilliant at first, and which then kind of slightly faded for you.
Well, I mean, my film career has been about as unsatisfactory, as far as I'm concerned, as any film career I know of. I just... it always was a struggle. It never... I just... it started off much too high, and obviously there's no way to live up to that. Mm. As Moss Hart said to me when I first met him, before I was married to Bogie, but after To Have and Have Not came out, and after the reviews came out, he said, of course you realize, from here on in, you have no way to go but down. No, I mean, he was an adorable man, but it was absolutely true.
Yeah, but at 19, you don't want to hear those words, kid.
No, it was absolutely the truth, though, because you couldn't, the way critics, the superlatives, there's no way you can live up to that, because they're out of all proportion to reality anyway. So you're put on this ridiculous pedestal at this ridiculous height, and you can only fall. And also, I was a kid, I didn't know how to act. I really didn't know. And so I had to learn in front of everybody.
Yeah, but it may have been easier to learn on screen than it would have been in the theatre, actually. Because in the theatre, you had to go out for the whole length of that time, so to speak. On screen, you do it in short little patches.
Well, except I'll tell you something. I think that the medium of the stage actually has suited me better. I think obviously there's a reason that I wanted to go on stage, because... I like to have a beginning and a middle and an end, and I like to build. Yeah. And film, although I feel much more comfortable now than I used to feel, it always terrified me. And that silence, and that grinding in action, and you have to, when they say action, you've got to start. And it just would make me shake, that's all. I couldn't do anything but shake. So, it was. But then, you make choices in your life, and my choice was my marriage and my children. And it better have been, because Bogart would not have accepted less than that. I've always been told don't marry actresses, and I've only married actresses. But if you're not around, the marriage will be badly affected. And I believe that he was absolutely correct, because I don't think separations are good for marriages. And I think if you go off with your own career, and you leave your husband behind. I just think it's unhealthy. It may be all right once, but I don't think it's okay as a pattern to
I know,
to
but staggering words from you, in a sense, because why not a woman's career coming first?
Well, I know that's true now, but as I never had a feminist problem, because my mother was a worker and I was always brought up to work, so I that never seemed to be an obstacle for me. But Bogie always felt that, and also I was a baby, and he was established, so why wouldn't he come first, And he'd never had children, and why shouldn't he have had?
I wanted to do all that,
change his life, and
And surely you were happy doing that.
Oh, Absolutely.
What? Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I was couldn't have been luckier. And unfortunately, I've never been anywhere near as lucky since. You know, I had all the luck early on and not a lot after.
Mm. Did you anticipate, did you know when you, well, when you marry somebody much older than yourself, and you must have, in a sense, anticipated knowing that he, presumably he was going to die before you.
Oh, I don't think you ever think
You don't
of
think
that.
Of it like that?
Oh, no. I just thought it was going to go on forever.
Hmm.
I mean, I'd convinced him it would go on forever, too, because he was filled with reservations about whether he should marry somebody so much younger than himself and that I would take off because I was so inexperienced and hadn't seen anything of life. And his friend Peter Lorre said to him, listen, if it's only 5 years, it'll be 5 years more than you've ever had, so it's better than nothing.
He warned you against affairs, didn't he? He said that affairs only harm yourself, they don't harm the other person.
Yes, because it had to do with character.
Mm.
He was very strong on character, and he believed that it didn't matter. He even believed it was wrong to think about it.
Really?
Yes.
But he
because
could say
he
that...
Because he thought that it cut into... It created a separation between two people, which in a way is true, actually, if you stop to think about it, you know, that you're already thinking about somebody else, which means that there's something that you cannot be open about. And I suppose, I mean, it was fine with him to tell me because he was teaching me, really.
He was, but why were you, at 19, it must have been quite hard for you, beautiful lady, not to think, well, crikey, I want to find out about men.
Well, because if you fall in love with someone and just, you really don't think beyond that.
No.
And that's all I wanted. And it was more important to me than anything.
Do you think you really met the person, like I do think there are some times in your life that you meet somebody and you really love that person and that person really was meant for you, right?
Yeah, well, sloppy I'm totally words, fatalistic about all of that.
You,
anyway.
You think
oh,
so?
Oh, totally. I think things happen that are meant to happen. And I think when they don't happen, they're not meant to happen.
Hmm.
I really believe that. I suppose to a degree I believe in astrology because I think that there are some things that we're fated for and that we can't avoid. I think we can change our lives, obviously. But if you think about your own life, at certain times, your life begins to change. But it's really because you've begun to become restless with the way it is or has been, and you want to change. And what the change is, maybe you're not quite certain of. And then suddenly something comes along and it happens. It happens because you're ready for it. But it's...
Well, you know, Michael Tippett, I interviewed recently, he said the thing about change, which I thought was very interesting, that in fact, when you choose, you know, you want to change something in your life, you might choose, often people choose badly. Then you see people choosing well. And his point is that if you know yourself rather well, then you tend to choose accurately. And I think that's not a bad thought. I mean...
I don't think it's a bad thought. I wish it
were
true.
You don't agree.
I wish I'd chosen accurately. No, I mean, I have...
But you seem to have known yourself from quite an early age.
Well, I knew some things, but if you're an incurable romantic as I am, I have not chosen awfully well in my... a lot of my life. I was damn lucky, but... Also,
do you mean choose? You've chosen a career that seems to have gone quite well. You've certainly taken the reins in your hands and become an applauded stage star, haven't you?
Yes. That is absolutely a choice that I made. But I was willing to take chances, which I am and have always been, which is why I'm doing Sweet Bird of Youth, because I believe in taking chances. I believe that you have to find out really what you can do and that there's only one way to find out, and that's by doing it. And if you fall on your rear, you fall. But at least you found out something, and I think you have to try. I don't believe in playing it safe. You know, you can't do that.
You've got to push yourself as far as you can push yourself.
I think so.
Yes. But do you like the part that you're going to play in the Tennessee Williams play?
Well, I think it's fascinating. I mean, it's a woman, again, in a way, I seem to always end up playing women that are, in one way or another, terribly frustrated and terrified of losing their power and their youth because of, in this case, work-related.
Mm. Are you?
And
are you yourself really
terrified? No.
No.
I'm not crazy about it.
No, quite.
You know, but I'm not.
Not many advantages,
no,
but still.
But I'm not really. No, I'm not really terrified of that. I mean, first of all, there's not a damn thing you can do about it. So I feel that the time has come, and I don't know why I've decided that I should be the guinea pig, but I have. I'm so fed up with the preoccupation with youth. I'm so tired of everyone having facelifts and having to look good and have no lines and everyone competing with 20-year-old girls. I mean, I think it is ridiculous. Mm. I think somehow you have got to learn, and they say, but it's your profession. I don't believe that. I think one has got to learn to live with what one is. And as I say, I may be cutting my own throat, it may be stupid, but I feel that you have to make yourself deal with things as they are. Mm. And we all want to look better. Everyone does. I mean, that's not original. But one gets older, younger people come up. That is the cycle of life. That's the way it has to be. Nobody adores it. But that's the way it is. Mm.
But nobody needs to push people out because of age, though. I think it's quite an ageist age, actually.
Oh, yes, but I mean that you have to stay there forever. You have to be there. Yeah. You have to be 20 years old for your whole life. Mm. I mean, I think it's absolutely ridiculous. I just think it's wrong. And I think that people become so preoccupied with that. The whole thing is phony. I think it's based probably on the fact that I am so devoted to truth that I feel that's also part of the lie, and I just think that it's, who are you kidding?
Have you rubbed people up the wrong way by being so devoted to the truth?
Definitely.
Yeah.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I that's one thing I certainly did learn from Bogey. I thought Bogey was, if people think I'm extreme, they should have known him. I mean, he always used to say, if you don't want to hear the truth, don't ask me.
Mm.
I always feel that it's better to know. I mean, obviously, I'm not going to kill somebody with words. I'm not going to be blunt. I'm not out to hurt people. That, I mean, that does not interest me, and I don't see any point in that. But I do not believe in any relationship, whether it be business or professional or personal. I don't believe in any relationship based on lies, because I think trust is essential. And I couldn't have a friend that I didn't trust, a real friend. And I believe that one must be honest. Mm. It's, and I think it's so much simpler because when you start to lie, I mean, someone's going to find out. You know, you always find out.
But you, were you brought up with that strong idea?
Oh, yes. My mother was. See, my mother and Bogey, who were contemporaries, were, I mean, I always was brought up from the beginning like that. My mother and my uncle and my mother's family always were, it was always character. Like character. You must not betray your character. You must have character. And character is not so easy to come by.
Your mother gave you that feeling, didn't she, from very early on?
Mm.
That as a girl, it didn't matter that you were a girl, that you could, if you wanted to, do anything you wished.
Yes.
You really wanted to do it. Yeah.
She was totally, totally supportive.
Yes.
Always. Always. And she worked, I mean, she was a secretary, but she was the best secretary you ever saw. I mean, she was fantastic. And she had to work to pay the rent. Mm. But she always supported me. I mean, when I wanted to be an actress, my grandmother, her mother, was horrified. You know, acting.
What kind of job
is
that?
What kind
is
of
it a job?
Terrible, yeah. All those terrible people, those fast people, and you don't want to be with them, and get a decent job, you know. But my mother always supported me. Mm. She always felt that I could do everything.
But does that, has that given you that feeling as a woman, that you therefore could do everything? I mean, that when
no.
You said you're not a particular feminist by nature.
I'm no, because I've all, as I say, I'm not a feminist because I've always worked. Mm. And so I feel I don't have to push for that.
That you're
believe.
Not, but what about other women?
For
but I
women? Believe in equal rights and I believe in choice, absolutely.
Mm.
And I think the wonderful thing about the feminist movement is that a lot of women have realized that they have a choice and that they can do something else. I think the bad thing about it is a lot of women have gone absolutely ape and they've left their husbands and they suddenly want to be independent. Mm-hmm. But I mean, anything that's too extreme, whatever it is usually a problem.
Because you see, do you realize what an impact you had when you were 19 in that first film, To Have and Have Not, when you appeared on that screen? You devastated the rest of us, you know.
Oh, see, I have no comprehension at all, none at all of that.
But you see, you were suddenly this woman that we could attain to be. I mean, Greta Garbo, whom you were likened to, was the kind of rather removed beauty in a sense, right?
Ravishing.
And she wanted to be alone, and my goodness, she scampered off and was alone. There were you in this sudden limelight as this new, rather tomboy, rather, but you know, wonderfully witty, wonderful independent woman.
Mm.
There were you, and there were all of us trying to get your voice, trying to do everything like you, because you gave us hope. It's what you weren't a sex symbol. Don't say
no.
Don't start saying you weren't sexy.
No. I understand. I understand, but I had no comprehension of that at all.
Well, how couldn't you have had that?
Well, because I don't know. You don't. It's like people that say, "Oh, this one was afraid of you, and this one, you're so sure of yourself." I know how sure of myself I am.
Hmm.
And I know that I'm not that sure of myself.
No.
But people get ideas about what you are, but you know you're not those things.
I know, but then...
And it was a part. It wasn't me. It was a part that I played.
But did it become a bit like you? Surely part of you was in the part, and part of
yes,
that part became
that's
you.
That's true. And I think as I've gotten older, I've become more like Bogart than Bogart. You know, I think that you take on the aura of the people that you're exposed to. And I suppose, in a way, I mean, some of that personality rubs off on you. But also, it's a combination of other things. The fact that I've lived alone so much, I suppose, has made me build up some kind of wall to protect myself. Mm. So that I give the impression of being much stronger than I am.
Yeah, but when you were 19 and the fame hit you, how did you stop? I mean, it was an absolute overnight fame.
Well, it was because I was focusing on Bogie.
Exactly. You were so in love that that was the distraction.
If I had not had him, God knows what would have happened.
No.
I mean, because I don't think you can cope with all of that. Mm. I really think that anyone that hits it big at too young an age, how do you deal with it?
Mm.
How do these tennis players that make millions of dollars that are big stars when they're 18 years old, how on earth does anyone expect them to deal with any of that? You can't. It's too much to cope with.
So did you run for your life, so to speak, inside the love you felt for Bogart then? Do you see what I mean?
Did you evade
part of that responsibility?
No, I don't think I did. I always wanted to be an actress. I always wanted to reach stardom, attain stardom. I always wanted that. But because at that time, it was so connected with Bogie anyway because of the film. And he was married and he was not happy and all of that, and he wanted to get a divorce, but he was filled with fears and anxieties about the age difference and everything and whether it was really the right thing to do for me. And I was trying to convince him that it was the right thing to do and not to worry, and who cared about age, and age didn't matter and so on. So that I mean, it was not a conscious effort at all of mine. And my career definitely suffered.
Mm.
I had to continue my focus. And then after we were married a few years and I was really not getting any decent offers because everyone began to think of me as Bogie's wife.
Mm.
And then you say, well, now, wait a minute. I still want to act. I still want to do good things. And he didn't want me not to act.
No, but he didn't want you to be...
He didn't want me to take off. He didn't want me to leave home.
Yeah.
Can't blame him for that.
No.
You know. So it was never conscious.
No, but when you started to play the role on screen, quite interesting, and when you were going to take on the role of the woman in the Tennessee Williams play, right? Do you actually begin to think it...
You mean now on the stage?
Yeah. When you take on roles, either in film or on stage, do you ever feel that they are representing some part of you, the woman, or are you just simply adapting to the words given to you by the person?
Oh, I think it's both.
Mm.
And as I was saying before, again, I'm playing a woman alone,
mm.
which it seems, in a way, I've done. on the stage.
And you are in
and
life,
I am.
As you say.
Yes. And so I suppose it's a comedy. I mean, you are the tool through which the play and the part are realized. Mm. And you obviously use yourself and you draw upon your own experiences and what you are. So I suppose in a way, I mean, I identify with some part of this woman. Less in a way with this character because of her her addiction to booze and pills and drugs, and which is not, it's never been a problem of mine.
But she likes to get distracted by sex.
Yes, 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 that it makes her forget. Yes, that it's the only thing that makes her forget.
That I find it,
you know,
I
she
find
was terrified of failure, but I understand her fears.
Of?
Her fear of having to face the rest of her life not being able to function as a woman who depended on her position in film as a star and as an artist, that she suddenly finds, or is terrified to feel that she ran from it because she felt that she had failed. And what would she do with the rest of her life? And she had to fill up the time somehow and forget.
See, you must have, mustn't
See,
you?
I don't ever forget is my problem.
No, but you must have at one point worried terribly whether you were going to function again. I mean, you had two children where you had to function through.
But it is the nature of my profession to worry about that because we never know whether we are going to function again. I mean, to be an actress is just insanity because there is no way to ever be sure that you will have 5 years between jobs, 1 year, 1 month. You do not know. It is totally undependable profession. And you spend your life auditioning and proving that you have talent, that you can do something, because most of the time people don't believe it.
So it's
a continual life of rejection.
So why?
Because I'm a masochist. I don't know. I'm crazy. But I mean, I have a son who's an actor. And whatever you tell your children. I was talking to Joan Plowright about it last night. Because she and Larry have three children. They all are involved with the theater. We tell them the pitfalls. We know what they are. It doesn't mean that I would have done anything else because I'm a glutton for punishment, but everyone has to make their own choice.
It's glamorous, you see, from the outside, isn't it? And you must be there for glamorous for the children
but
to see
you. But
it's
not glamorous. But,
no,
but they know,
but
that they know that it's hard work. But it's something. There is something in us that makes us
want to be somebody else.
Yes, exactly, exactly.
Surely
need to hide
behind
some facade in order to let out all that we have inside.
You have let out, I think, some of what you have inside for me today. Thank you.
Oh.
Lauren Bacall.
Thank you.
Been a great fan of yours all the time.
All of your life?
No, all of my
your
life.
Your nanny?
I'm on, no, 6 years younger. Just a reminder that Lauren Bacall opens in Sweet Bird of Youth this May in Bath and later in the West End. Good afternoon. No, 6 years younger than you, Mrs.